let's get into our top 10 films of 2018. As I mentioned, we're going to be talking about other top 10 picks as well, but we're going to start with our own real quick here. Will Ashton, what is your number 10 of 2018?
Yeah, so this is a pick that I was changing literally at the last minute, as John can attest. I was back and forth a lot. I was trying to figure out where I would land on 10, and there's a good chance that in like a week or two, this one won't be in my top 10.
Just check back in tomorrow.
Given yeah. Some, yeah, who knows? But as I stand right now, I decided to go with Incredibles 2. Which is not to say it's the best superhero movie of 2018, and I don't think it's like the most accomplished, well-made film either. I think you can point out a lot of its problems story-wise. I think there's a lot of issues you can make, as many people have already. But for me, as looking back on this year, which is, as I said before, like I think a really great year for superhero films and for animation, this one really stood out to me. I admittedly am nostalgic because Incredibles 1 is one of my favorite movies. So it did kind of fill me with that childlike glee that I don't often get. But there was just something, I just think it's really well made. I think there's a lot to like here. I do think the jokes are great. I think the characters are still just as well developed as they were before. And I really enjoyed my time here. I think this is some of the most fun I've had in the movies in 2018. And yeah, I just looked back on 2018. This is the film that, at least for me, really like lifted my spirits and got me into a good vibe. So I'm going to put it at number 10.
Incredibles 2. It's in my honorable mentions. I really like this film a lot, and it had some of my favorite moments of the year. I'm right there with you. It just, for me, it was a really tough year because there were just a few films that were over the top for me in this one. And I guess this was your favorite superhero film. I mean, I don't want to, you know, spoil the rest of your list, but I don't think you chose any other superhero films.
No, yeah, this is the only one that made my top 10. But if, like I said, really great year for superhero movies. Yeah. Yeah. And yeah.
All right. Incredibles 2. It's on several other lists as well. We had Matthew Serafini. He put it as his number 7, or sorry, his number 9. And wow. Jake Holland put it as his number 7. Jonathan Carlin had it at number 5. Aaron Dicer had it at number 4. And the person who had it the highest on any list was Craig Hanks, who had it at number 3. So that's Incredibles 2. Great film, and not surprising to see a Pixar film making a lot of lists this year, even though it is a sequel. And I have a feeling, you know, if this was Coco, it would probably have been a bigger splash among some of the Cinemaholics. Yeah. But yeah, great pick. All right, my number 10 film is Wildlife.
Sorry I'm late.
Talk to your father. Tell him not to act like a fool.
I am not being foolish. I put my name on a list. I waited for my chance, and now they finally have a place for me.
You don't know anything about fires. You'll get burned up.
Well, I've been reading about them. I know enough.
You've been reading about them? You've been studying up?
Don't turn my words on me, Gene.
Dad, what's going on?
Your father is leaving us to go and fight those wildfires.
What? Dad, why?
Ethan, Jerry, you won't take a job at a grocery store, but you'll go out with a bunch of deadbeats and risk getting killed.
I have to go there and leave it.
What does it pay?
What?
What does it pay?
I could talk all day about this film, and I think I've already have at one point. I saw this one back in early November. I talked about it on this show soon after. I forget which specific episode it was, but if you haven't had a chance to see it, I thoroughly recommend it. This film chronicles the crumbling marriage of a tight-knit family in 1960s Montana. I know that doesn't sound like the most riveting story, but okay. So the father, played by Jake Gyllenhaal, is out of a job. He decides to risk his life and sort of abandon his family by battling the wildfires for really a pittance of money. So he leaves his wife, played by Carey Mulligan, and his teenage son, played by Ed Oxenbould, to take care of themselves in the aftermath, with odd jobs and new relationships. It's a troubling, balanced, yet all too moody depiction of what can ruin a marriage, as well as the dignity that we tend to assign to that institution. It's a universal tale. It takes place in the 1960s, but it feels relevant to today. This is a film, too, with a nearly perfect triple performance here from Mulligan, Gyllenhaal, and Oxenbould. Only one other film in 2018, in my opinion, rivals this sort of triple threat, and we might discuss that film a little later. Now, Will, I know this one, it came pretty close to making your top 10, and it is one of the few films for a while that you and I both had in our top 10.
Yeah, it was at number 10 for me for a while, and it was very close. And I really liked the film a lot, too. I didn't get a chance to talk about it on the show. But yeah, I really was taken by it. I'm bummed it's not really getting that much consideration critically or commercially as far as the other films are concerned that we're going to be talking about. But yeah, I really liked it. And I think it's easily among the best debuts of the year and certainly among the best performances of the year for Carey Mulligan and Jake Gyllenhaal, as well as what was the kid's name again? I forget.
Ed Oxenbould. And you know, I did mention, of course, Paul Dano and Zoe Kazan, who did this film. And they, like you said, wonderful debut. I think that they have a great collaboration ahead of them. I think they work really well together. And they're, of course, also romantic partners. And it's a very interesting dynamic. But that said, you know, this film also made it onto a few other lists. Kimber Myers and Abby Olchesi both put Wildlife on their list as their number 5 pick. So they liked it even more than us. And I can see why. Okay, next up. Number 9. Will Ashton, what is your number 9 pick?
Yeah, so for me, number 9 is the Fred Rogers documentary, Won't You Be My Neighbor, which was directed by Morgan Neville. And as I said before, it explores the life and career of Fred Rogers, probably best known as Mr. Rogers, who through his television show, PBS, so not public access, but through his television show, he was able to inspire and motivate and move and remind everybody of capturing that childhood glee and also speaking to children in a way that was treating them seriously, but also not, you know, letting them fully into the darkness of adulthood. And it's a really touching movie. I think it captures Fred Rogers really well. And he is one of my idols from growing as a kid. I mean, obviously, I'm from Pittsburgh, so he is a folklore here. He's a big deal. And it was it's not an easy task to make a movie that is worthy of Mr. Rogers, but I think Morgan Neville did it very well. And it was a really great reminder of why we need people like Mr. Rogers. And it's really a shame that he's no longer with us. But I think it's safe to say that his impact is still with us. And I think the movie really captures why that impact is still with us. And I hope the biopic with Tom Hanks that's coming out, I believe, sometime this year.
From is going Dr. Marielle Heller.
Yeah.
Who did Can You Ever Forgive Me, a film that might get brought up later.
Yeah. So I hope that movie is at least as good as this one. But I think this documentary really spoke to me, and I'm glad it got made. So that's my number 9 pick.
I love this film as well. It made my honorable mentions. It was on my top 10 for quite a while this year, and it's such a great theater experience, you know, seeing it with a lot of other people. It's such a generational film, you know, one of those things that you can see with your parents, you can see it with your kids, your siblings. Everyone has some sort of connection to Mr. Rogers, and even if they don't, they can get something out of this film as well to learn about this really great man. So I'm glad this film is out there, and I think Morgan Neville really hit it out of the park, and it made a few other lists as well. It was Candace Frederick's number 8 pick, and it was Skyla Schuler's number 8 pick as well. And the person who had the highest was Matthew Serafini. Once again, Matt had it as his number 2. So great showing for Won't You Be My Neighbor. Well-deserved praise all around. Now, before we get into my number 9 pick, we do have a special message from a Cinemaholic who decided to let us know what he thinks about his favorite film of the year.
Hello, my name is Aaron Dicer, and I am a Cinemaholic. Hi, Aaron. And I have no desire to stop being one, because movies are awesome. 2018 was incredible, but Roma was the best movie of the year. Which is interesting because I wasn't even sure I liked Roma until I got about 30 minutes in. I had to kind of feel my way around it, but then it locked in a way where it just owned me, and it has every time I've seen it since. Yes, I've watched it 3 times. I know people say it's a movie they don't want to watch more than once. I don't get that, because the nuance of the way Cuarón reveals the metaphor and message of this film is absolute genius. Every time I watch it, new stuff pops out to me, new, just little pieces of foreshadowing that I would have never picked up on It's a movie about life and death living in the same frame, about joy and sadness living in the same frame. It's a movie about motherhood and what it means to mother and what it means to be a caretaker and the technical achievement of the film, the type of black and white photography he used, the sound mix that just felt like you were actually living in this place, the characters, the performances, the moments. It's everything I love about cinema, and it has kept me thinking and remembering and recalling. And honestly, that's what's going to rocket it up my list, is that it stays with me in a way that I can't stop thinking about it. And that's why it ends up as my number one amidst an incredible amount of amazing movies this year that also stayed with me, but none as much as Roma.
All right, that was Aaron Dicer from the Sift Pop podcast. Love Aaron Dicer's work. Definitely subscribe to Sift Pop when you get a chance. They're fantastic. My number nine pick, as you can sort of guess, is also Roma. Roma, I've said so much about this film already, so I don't want to go overboard here. You know, we reviewed the film in early December. It's still holding a deep place in my heart to this day. This is the black and white family drama directed by Alfonso Cuarón. It takes place in Mexico City and features the new coming talent of Yalitza Aparicio, who could possibly get a few nominations down the road at some awards. Don't miss this one on the big screen if you can, but otherwise, be sure to give it a look on Netflix. You'll be glad you did, because it is far and away one of the best films of the year and one that will last the test of time, I think. And I'm not the only fan of Roma, of course. I mean, this film made it onto six other top 10 lists we have. Three people put it as their number two of the year, and another three put it as their number one. So you heard Aaron, of course, praising the film. That it was his number one. But also Candice Frederick, who we mentioned. She's from Harper's Bazaar. And Cian John, and our giveaway winner, patron. They both have this as their number one film of the year. So that's Roma. And I think, Will, yeah, you're going to be able to... I think, did this one make any of your honorable mentions, or?
No, it did, definitely. I alluded to it earlier, but I do think if I had to break it down, I think Roma is probably the best film of 2018. Okay. It very nearly made my list, but yeah, it's a tremendous film. I really hope people check it out either on Netflix or in theaters if they still can. But yeah, really great film, and another one out of the park for Alfonso Cuarón.
Definitely agree with you there. Okay, Will Ashton, your number eight pick. Let's hear it.
Sure. This is the one that I think surprised you when I sent my top 10 list.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
I still can't believe it.
I don't know why, because it's probably going to win Best Picture, but...
that's true.
Maybe, I don't know. Who knows? It's still an early race, but I think this is probably going to win. It's A Star is Born, which is the directorial debut of Bradley Cooper, starring Cooper and Lady Gaga, as well as Andrew Dice Clay, Dave Chappelle... a bunch of other people who I can't think of on top of my head.
Tell me something, boy. Aren't you tired trying to fill that void? Or do you need more? Ain't it hard keeping it so hardcore?
Is that me?
That's you.
You just write that now?
Yeah.
Pretty good.
I would be hard-pressed, I think, to call it one of the best films of the year, only in the sense that I think it has a lot of story problems that are justified, and you can always go with the, what does this film say that hasn't been said in the other versions, but I think there's a lot that does get said. But I think for me, looking at my emotional resonance with films in 2018, and as Roger Ebert once said, films are empathy machines, something like that, I'm paraphrasing. But just looking at the films that really spoke to me on an emotional level, that really captured the most out of me on a human level, I think A Star is Born is probably the film that got the biggest response out of me. It just really took me through a whirlwind of emotions, and you could say it's manipulative, sure. You can say that it kind of plays the audience in certain ways, but it worked. I think it really, really works, and I think Bradley Cooper gives his best performance in the film, and I think it's tremendous that he was able to get his best performance out of his own direction, and I think he's probably going to win Best Actor for this, and I think it's well-deserved. I think he really knocked it out of the park, and I can't can't help but really enjoy this film. So it's my number 8 pick.
You know, I do think it's a good film, and I think it's getting some good praise, and I totally understand it. I guess for me, this thing's second two acts just don't quite work for me in a way that does hinder this film from being higher up on my list. It didn't even make my honorable mentions, but there were so many moments in this film that I truly did love. This is a film that really understands what we love about music and what celebrity culture translated to today is compared to The Star is Born from the 70s, The Star is Born from the 50s and 30s. And I do think this is a good film. And if it wins Best Picture, I will not be heartbroken in the slightest, because there's some great filmmaking going on here. There's a great opening scene, and there's a tracking shot involving Bradley Cooper in this film that I do think is masterclass. And it is pretty impressive that he is debuting with this film. It's a great way to start a filmmaking career for him, and I hope to see him just push it forward and put out even better work. Now, we have other people who put Star is Born on their list. Adonis Gonzalez had it at number 6. Skylar Schuller had it as his number 5. And Brandon Katz had it the highest. He put it as his favorite film of the year. It's his number 1. So if Brandon Katz is deciding the Oscars, Will Ashton, then I guess Star is Born is going to be Best Picture. So, all right.
We'll see.
All right. So my next pick, my number 8, is First Man. This is from director Damien Chazelle, best known for directing Whiplash and La La Land. Two very different films from this one, obviously. And you know, Will, in preparation for this list, I had no idea so many other people, so many fellow Cinemaholics were as into this film as I was. You know, I thought this was a film, you know, that really was going to miss a lot of people's lists, but it's on 5. And despite receiving what I thought was kind of a tepid reaction from critics and definitely a middling box office, but you know, I'm not alone in thoroughly loving this film about Neil Armstrong's fateful moon landing, portrayed here by Ryan Gosling, with Claire Foy in the role of his wife at the time, Janet. You know, I think this film is a wonderwork. It truly captures the miraculous horror of this space mission in 1969 and the technical challenges that occurred along the way, coupled with emotional hurdles that Armstrong faced in the lead up to this really grievous undertaking. You know, it was a marvel to see this on IMAX. It pains me to think that most people who skipped the theatrical release were going to have to settle for a small screen experience in the future. But, you know, we had a more detailed conversation about First Man back in October. You may want to give it a listen. I really think it's worth people's times. If they didn't give it a shot, if they thought that the critical reaction wasn't good enough, or if they just missed it for whatever reason, I think it's worth checking out as soon as you can. You know, as I mentioned, 5 other people had this one on their list. Matt Serafini had it as his number 6. Sam Noland had it as his number 5. Skylar Schuller had it as his number 4. Cian John had it as his number 3. And Aaron Dicer had it at the highest as his number 2 for the whole year. Has your opinion changed on this one a little bit at all, Will?
I don't know if it's changed, but it's definitely of the films that have come out in 2018. I think it's the one I'm most anxious to revisit, because I had really high expectations going in. And for some reason, I do think it's one of the best made films of 2018, certainly from a technical standpoint, but it didn't quite hit me as hard as it hit other people. And, you know, it happens. Sometimes the movie just doesn't hit you the same way it hits other people. But I want to check it out again to revisit and see if my opinion changed, because I do really like Damien Chazelle's work. I think his last two films were high up in my end of year list for their respective years. So maybe my opinion on this film will change over time, but for now, it didn't hit me quite as hard as the other films I'm going to list.
Yeah. You know, Whiplash was my favorite film of 2014, and La La Land was in my top 5. So, great filmmaker, and I think this is another great film from him. So, next up, we have another message, not a recording this time, but Julia Tatey wrote in to talk about her favorite film. Julia is going to be in our upcoming episode of, we're going to be talking about If Beale Street Could Talk in a little bit more detail, but that's not the movie she sent us. So she wrote about a film that is her number one that I don't think was on anybody else's list. Actually, no, I misspoke. It was on a few other lists, maybe one or two. Mm-hmm. But here is what Julia wrote into us. I'm going to read it aloud here. In another tremendous year for cinema, Deborah Granick's naturalistic, quiet drama, Leave No Trace, stands apart. Ruminating on intense, harsh themes, Granick's direction is gentle and makes us feel safe at home. Thomasin McKenzie and Ben Foster's respective performances are affecting, even haunting, as they maneuver the landscape of the world and their own limitations. Leave No Trace stays with you after you've seen it, acting as a meditation on all we are capable of giving and our own shortcomings for those we love. That's from Julia Tatey. She writes for The Playlist and a lot of other great websites. We're really excited to have her on the show for the first time.
Yeah.
We bent the rules a little bit because we kept us as Cinemaholics contributors. She's a future contributor, Will Ashton. So that's how we decided it was going to be all right.
Right. Yeah. Can't wait to talk to her next week.
Yeah. So Leave No Trace. I really like that film too. It really is a testament to how good this year was for films that this didn't make my top 10 or honorable mentions. But I really loved this film. It's so good. But there were just so many others that I think affected me a little bit more, but I do think Thomasin McKenzie has one of the best performances of the year here.
Yeah, this is actually one of the ones I didn't get a chance to see. I was debating watching yesterday. It just didn't work out, but it was really, I'm going to probably check it out this week, and who knows, it might end up in my top 10. But yeah, unfortunately, as of this time, I haven't seen it, so I can't weigh in.
I definitely hope you're able to catch it soon. But okay, next up, number 7, Will Ashton, what did you pick?
Yeah, so for number 7, I picked what might be both the most relevant and depressing movie of 2018, which is First Reformed. This is the new film from writer-director Paul Schrader, starring Ethan Hawke, Amanda Seyfried, or is it Seyfried or Seyfried?
I think it's Seyfried.
No, Seyfried?
That's my
guess. Amanda Seyfried. Yeah, sorry, Amanda Seyfried or Seyfried, and Cedric the Entertainer. This movie, for me, looking back on 2018, as far as like my mental state, maybe just with anxiety and just current events and the media and whatnot, the film that I felt really captured just my like kind of turmoil and just trying to figure out my place in the world and figuring out like what can I do anything, like what can happen, like, is things really hopeless? Is there a reason for hope or anything like that? I think that film, the film that really captured that for me was First Reformed. And that's not to say that it's just because of that that the film is on this list. I just also think it's really a tremendous piece of work. Paul Schrader has been a filmmaker who has really shown his talents. Obviously, he's the screenwriter of Taxi Driver and Raging Bull, among other films. But the past couple of years, he's really struggled to get his vision across. He's had at least 2 or 3 films that have been basically disasters, either in production or post-production. So it was really great to see him actually make a good film again. But it also just showcased, I think, everything his career has been leading up to, just the way he challenges faith in his films. The way that he kind of sees himself, the way he uses his influences and his work. And it really just kind of accumulated into a film that I think will stand out as not only one of the year's best, but one of his ultimately best films as well. So, yeah, I really, really liked it. It really stuck out to me, and it's my number 7 pick.
Yeah, great film. It's in my honorable mentions, and I love Ethan Hawke so much. I just think he's a terrific actor. If he's in a movie, I'm going to see it. I don't care if it's a low-budget genre film or if it's a prestige film that no one's talking about. Ethan Hawke is somebody who's so passionate about film, and it comes across in his performance here. I love how this film tackles faith, how it attacks human beings and the environment, and it asks some seriously tough questions that need to be asked more, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. So First Reformed, great film, and it made a bunch of other lists as well. It's on 5 other lists. It made the number 8 spot for Aaron Dicer. It's the number 7 pick as for Julia Tatey, who picked it as number 7, same as you. It made the number 4 spot for Chris Sheridan. Abby Olchesi and Kaylee Donaldson have it in the same spot. They both put it as their number 3. So great film and clearly a Cinemaholics favorite for the most part. So First Reformed. Okay, my number 7 pick was The Favorite, from director Yorgos Lanthimos. And I'm so happy to say that, Will, because I was so anticipating this one, and I'm so glad it paid off and that I wasn't disappointed.
Are the people really angry about the land tax?
They'll be angry when the French are sodomizing their wives and planting their fields with garlic.
The Tories must not be rowed roughshod over, though.
And more dead if we do it.
It is painful to lose men, but we cannot be half-hearted in this, or they will see our weakness and take us, and we will lose thousands more. None for the Queen.
What?
Well, you cannot have hot chocolate. Your stomach, the sugar inflames it.
Abigail, hand me that cup.
Do not.
I'm sorry. I do not know what to do.
Oh, fine. Give it to her. And then you can get a bucket and a mop for the aftermath.
Okay, so this is another film that we discussed recently on Cinemaholics, but you know, I'm going to reiterate my pure love for this wickedly impure, dark, endlessly clever reimagining of the British monarchy, specifically with Queen Anne, portrayed here by the impeccable Olivia Colman, with Rachel Weisz and Emma Stone playing the two ladies of the court who spar for her favor in more and more outrageous ways. You know, I wasn't quite as taken with Lanthimos's other directorial efforts, including The Lobster and last year's The Killing of a Sacred Deer. I do really like those films a lot, but you know, this film with screenwriters Deborah Davis and Tony McNamara, it seems to blend everything I do love about Lanthimos's wit and knack for visual storytelling with a script that feels infused with some deeper purpose that I've always been wanting from him, which is what I've craved, you know, since Dogtooth. So, well, I know we disagree somewhat on the praise for this film, but I vaguely recall you liked it to an extent.
No, I definitely like it. Yeah, I mean, for me, though, it felt like Yorgos Lanthimos liked. It didn't. I felt like actually didn't quite tackle as much as the other films of his. I think just mainly because, like, I felt like with his other films, the writing and directing are usually in sync because they're both from him. And this one, there are a couple times where it didn't feel quite as tightly knit. But the performances are fantastic, and I do think it's a great introduction to Yorgos if you want to check out his stuff, but don't want to quite get into the nitty gritty darkness quite yet. So yeah.
I can sort of agree with that, but I will push back. I don't think it's Lanthimos light. I think it's Lanthimos balanced and reined in, pun intended. So that's my opinion. And, you know, I wasn't the only one who favored The Favorite and made five other lists. Brandon Katz has it as his number 9. Julia Tatey has it as her number 6. Robert Yanez has it as his number 5. Kimber Myers has it as her number 4. And Rebecca Paley has it at the highest. She gave it the number 2 pick for her year. Okay, so that's The Favorites. Next up, we have another message. This one is from Craig Hanks, and he's going to talk about his favorite film of the year.
Hey guys, this is Craig from the Legendarium podcast, and look, I've got a brand to maintain here. So for our 2018 top 10, we kept it to our favorite fantasy and sci-fi movies, loosely defined. Anyway, the list is pretty predictable, lots of Marvel and Disney stuff, but I think two entries might stand out. The first is Annihilation, which has probably been largely forgotten and which Paramount had no idea what to do with in the first place, and that's all too bad, really, because it's great, and we devoted an entire episode to discussing it and Ex Machina, Alex Garland's previous effort. The other standout was Overlord, the Nazi zombie movie, which was a well-written, extremely well-edited, and again, poorly marketed film. It was bloody, it was gooey, and it wasn't for everybody, but it was also a ton of fun, so 2018 wasn't a total loss. And now, happy 2019 to you, Cinemaholics, and here's hoping we'll see you all on the Legendarium.
All right, that was Craig Hanks from the Legendarium podcast. Wonderful podcast. He's been on the show before. I've been on Legendarium. Great show if you love science fiction and fantasy. You know, Craig's list, his top 10, is very sci-fi fantasy on brand. They definitely picked some films that really align with their interests, and it's a fantastic list. Craig, thank you for writing in and doing your recordings. So let's get into our number 6 picks. Well, this one, you know, I kind of just want to skip it. I don't want you to talk about this film. I'm still in protest, but go ahead. What is your number 6 of the year?
All right. So for number 6, I picked Brady Corbett's sophomore film, Vox Lux. It's not a film that particularly struck John's fancy, but it really spoke to me, at least, as far as how it tackled the relationship between trauma and pop culture.
To be clear, film, I'm so glad that you loved it.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm glad I liked it as well, but I'm disappointed that you didn't enjoy it, at least not to the extent that I did. But I felt like this movie, it's not perfect. It definitely, I think, grapples more than it can chew at some points, but I just think the ambition and the way that it speaks so much to how we process like post 9/11 or just our world right now. To me, this actually kind of spoke post 9/11 than Vice did in some ways. But I just felt like this movie, I don't want to say too much because I think the film is one of those films that is kind of just best experienced because there's a lot that goes on in the plot that you just kind of have to live through. But yeah, I really, really enjoyed it. I found it had a, I mean, it looked beautiful. I'm glad and disappointed that it got such a big rollout from Neon because I could see it in the best theatrical presentation, but it was mostly empty cinemas that it was presented to. But yeah, the stands, I could see this one being the most divisive on my list. It's definitely not a film for everyone. I think it has like a 62%, if that, on Rotten Tomatoes, but it really worked for me. And yeah, that's my number six pick.
Okay, you're not alone. Well, Ashton, two other people put it on their list. One person put it higher than you. First, there's Sam Noland. He put it as his number eight of the year. And Rebecca Paley put it as her number four. So definitely you don't have to feel like you're getting bombarded here. Clearly there was some love for Vox Lux. And so, yeah. All right, moving on. My number six pick is If Beale Street Could Talk from director Barry Jenkins. Again, just talked about this film on last week's show, so I guess you can say I've fallen in love rather quickly. This film is a brilliant overload of heart-wrenching story mixed with a sort of optimism that might feel foreign to some viewers. You typically see films about racial injustice and expect something kind of more cynical, but this film, it's melodic, it's perfectly crafted, and it's an absolutely stunning adaptation of James Baldwin's incredibly nuanced and tough-to-tackle voice. This is another film that you still have the chance to see in theaters over the next few weeks if you can. It has a wider release, and I hope more people do. I think that it's easily one of the best films of the year. And, you know, despite being a little underseen due to the release schedule, Beale Street has managed to land on six other lists besides mine. So Kimber Myers, Abiel Chessy, and Cian John all have it as their number seven, so pretty close to mine. May Abdul-Baki has it as her number four for the year. Brandon Katz has it at number three. And Candace Frederick has it at the highest. She put it as her number two film of the year.
Yeah, the big reason I think this one isn't on my list is because I just haven't had a chance to see it. Unfortunately, it doesn't come out here until next week or this Friday. So, yeah, I am bummed I didn't get the chance to see it before we put together this list, but really, really looking forward to it and can't wait to see it.
I can't wait to talk about it with you. Hopefully next week is the plan. So tentatively for now, we're going to talk about it in more detail. I've already talked a lot about the film, so I can't wait to hear more of what you have to say. And of course, what Julia has to say. So that's If Beale Street Could Talk. And your next film, Will, before we get into it, two other people had this film on their list. And not only did they have it on their list, they both put it as their number one. So Will, before you talk about it, let's hear from Kaylee Donaldson. Kaylee Donaldson wrote in, here's what she had to say. Kaylee Donaldson, of course, is a great writer for Pajiba. Follow her on Twitter. She's fantastic. She also has a great podcast called The Hollywood Read. You should definitely subscribe. But here is what Kaylee had to say about her favorite film of the year. In a year where women directors completely knocked it out of the park across the board, Lynn Ramsey was still head and shoulders above the rest. You Were Never Really Here may only be her fourth film, but it brims with the rebellious confidence of someone on their 14th film, abrasive, deliberately unsatisfying, and utterly unconcerned with simple ideas like closure or exposition. Her anti-noir subversion of the violent male hero was endlessly thrilling, even as it rejected the trappings of a conventional thriller. It made you realize just how much you hunger for the catharsis of on-screen violence by denying you the payoff, but leaving you with the traumatic aftermath. Calling any Joaquin Phoenix performance stellar is a common practice, but seldom has he done so much when saying so little. Side note, I have a theory that the more Joaquin Phoenix mumbles, the better the movie is. So of course, this is a masterpiece. No actor does as much work through sheer posture alone. He conveys the decades of trauma and suicidal ideation through casual dark humor, slouched movement, and efficient brutality. It won't win him an Oscar, but it should. The whole film should give Lynn Ramsey the freedom to do whatever she wants for the rest of her career. That was from Kaylee Donaldson. I absolutely love what she had to say about You Were Never Really Here.
That's great.
A film that, again, you're going to get into in a second, Will. I might be talking about a little bit later, spoiler alert. But before we move on, the other person who put this as their number one was Rebecca Paley, who sent, or Polly, excuse me, who sent us a recording. Here's what Rebecca had to say about You Were Never Really Here.
This is Rebecca Polly, associate editor at Box Office, and my favorite film of the year is Lynn Ramsey's You Were Never Really Here, starring Joaquin Phoenix as a hitman hired to rescue the daughter of a local politician. There's an action element here, but what really takes this film to the next level is that it is a nuanced, beautifully done character study about a traumatized man desperately trying to find some sort of connection with the world around him. It's the same sort of theme that was tackled with Paul Schrader's First Reformed. Unlike First Reformed, this script doesn't suck. Sorry. Like Lynn Ramsey's We Need to Talk About Kevin, You Were Never Really Here is a sort of film that will probably like make you feel like your heart cavity's been hollowed out by a rusty spoon. You might need a dose of Paddington 2 at the end to retain emotional equilibrium. That said, it is an absolute masterpiece from a director who is prone to making them.
All right, so Will Ashton, a lot of people are loving this film. It made two number one lists, but what about you? It's your number five. What do you think of this
one? Yeah, I'm trying to figure out what I can say that hasn't already been said at this point. But yeah, it's obviously, I mean, Lynn Ramsey is one of my favorite working filmmakers. I think that was solidified for me with her last film, We Need to Talk About Kevin. And I've been waiting with bated breath for what her follow-up film would be. There was at one point going to be a Western she was going to make called Jane Got a Gun, I believe. It didn't work out. There was quite a bit of controversy, but she finally came back with this film, and it had my favorite actor, Joaquin Phoenix, or at least my favorite working actor today. And it was based on a book I really, really enjoyed called, or of the same name, by Jonathan Ames. So I had a lot of expectations going in, and I was actually kind of nervous, I think, that I wasn't going to live up to my expectations. But yeah, I think it's a credit to everyone involved that despite my expectations for the film being sky high, it reached them and in some ways exceeded them. I think the film is beautiful in how it tackles such heavy material as far as the cyclical nature of violence and the way we process trauma. And it's such a well-realized, gorgeous film to look at, but just the way that it has this kind of poetic energy to it, I think that's the way you described if Bale Street could talk, but it just flows so effortlessly, and or not effortlessly, but it feels like it is like one's mindset, and it really captures what is going through this troubled, complicated character in a way that feels very organic, and it feels very effervescent, and it just is so good at what it's doing that I just find myself often thinking about this film and how it communicates stuff. And I think there's one scene in particular that might be the most gorgeous scene I saw in 2018. It involved a river. That's all I'll say if you haven't seen the film, but yeah, I really, really like this film. It's another one I've been dying to see again, just how it communicates everything it does so well. This is the one I think I actually could see going higher up my list if I think about it more, but for now it's my number five pick.
Yeah, while you were saying that, I was actually considering maybe I should push this one up a little bit. Yeah, this one's on my list as well, and we'll get into how the list break down in a moment when I talk about it, but You Were Never Really Here, fantastic film, definitely one that stuck with me, and then some, since I saw it early summer, so definitely worth checking out if you haven't already. Actually, I saw that in late spring, excuse me. But okay, before we move on, we have another personal message. This one is from Matt Serafini. His favorite film of the year is my number five pick. And let's hear from Matt.
If you're lucky, at some point in your life, you get a movie that really feels made for you. As a huge Spider-Man fan, a huge animation fan, and a huge fan of Phil Lord and Chris Miller, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is a movie that was made for me. It perfectly encapsulates everything I love about the character, his legacy, and what it all means to be Spider-Man. It's the ultimate Spider-Man movie. No pun intended. And that's not even touching the animation. I've never seen anything like this movie. It yanks the medium of animation forward and shows us what you can do if you take that leap of faith, as Sony thankfully did here. I'd argue that this is the best representation of a comic book movie that we've seen to date. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse is not only my favorite movie of 2018, but probably my favorite movie of the past 5 years at least. I'll be seeing it a third time this weekend, and I know I'll be watching it again and again in the near future.
All right, that was Matt Serafini from the It Ain't Ogre Till It's Ogre podcast. That's right, shouting out your podcast, Will Ashton, that you do on the side. And I can't wait to hear. I think, have you announced your season 3 for It Ain't Ogre Till It's Ogre?
Not officially, but I can now. We're going to tackle Garfield the movie, the 2004 adaptation of Jim Davis's comic. Can't wait. It's probably going to be our final season, but not officially. So we'll see. But yeah, that's what we're doing for season 3.
Great note to end on if that ends up being the case. But okay, so as I alluded earlier, this is my number 5 pick from Matt, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse. Very excited to talk about this one. I mean, no surprise here, but this is unquestionably a highly popular and highly praised film among critics and fans. And I think the box office is finally catching up to this reception. Again, you know, we talked about this film very recently on the show. I can only echo its praises. I've seen a repeated sentiment on Twitter this week too, where people are now wondering, is this film so good that we should dislike other superhero films a tiny bit less? And, you know, I understand that temptation as much as the rest of you. I truly believe it's a special, wonderful animated film and a high mark for multiple genres, which is all the more amazing. I still can't believe that Sony has pulled off something like this in an era where Disney and Marvel have felt a little untouchable, save for the rare exception. And I'm not alone. Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse made it onto a whopping 14 other lists submitted out of 24. It is far and away the film on the most lists we've compiled. So to save some time, I'm just going to mention that 3 people had it as their number one film. Of course, we mentioned Matt Serafini had it as his number one. Also, Jake Holland and Adonis Gonzalez had it as number one. Surprisingly enough, though, Spider-Verse is not the film with the most picks as number one. But we will get to that a little bit later. So Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse, and I think that made it into your honorable mentions, Will Ashton.
It did, yes.
Yeah, so definitely, you know, it got close, it sounds like, but definitely a very loved film. And for me, this was an easy choice. I'm glad it made it into my top 5. Now, related to superhero films, here is another recording. This one is from Robert Yanis Jr. from the Crooked Table podcast. Here he is talking about his favorite film of the year.
Hey, Cinemaholics. Robert Yanis Jr. here of the Crooked Table podcast. So many 2018 films offered rich social commentary, compelling performances, and thrilling spectacle, but no film combined all three quite like Black Panther. As the first Marvel Studios effort that feels not only fun but also significant, director Ryan Coogler's film was not only the year's highest-grossing domestic release, but proved to be a true cultural phenomenon. It tackles timely issues like the African-American experience, nationalism, identity, progress, and legacy with a delicate, nuanced touch that challenges moviegoers, all without sacrificing the heroics that viewers expect from their superhero epics. And for that, it's easily my favorite film of 2018.
All right, that was Robert Yanis Jr. talking about Black Panther. You and I, we didn't have it on our list, but Black Panther is very high up on other lists. It is definitely a clear favorite. I think a few people had it as their number one, and then a bunch of people had it number two, and all sorts of things like that. It definitely is a popular film for Cinemaholics, and I'd say deservedly so.
Yeah, for sure.